In this lecture, we will see the impurity levels in semiconductors. We know that introduction of dopants into semiconductors usually creates electronic energy levels within the semiconductor energy band gap. These electronic energy levels, can be placed into two categories. That is, first one is shallow levels, and the second one is deep levels. So first, let me explain shallow levels. So these levels are located near their related band edge. That is, near valence band for acceptors and conduction band for donors. So what is shallow level? If you draw here valence band and conduction band, if this is minimum of the conduction band, and this is top of the valence band, then shallow impurities or shallow levels are near the band edge. That is, if there are donors, then this level is, or these levels are near to conduction band, and if there are acceptors, then these levels are near to valence band. So these energy levels, which are near to their related bandages, are known as shallow levels. And these levels are 0.1 electron volt from the bandage. Therefore, these levels are thermally ionized at room temperature. The ionization energy of shallow levels can be approximately described by a modified hydrogenic model. The energy of these shallow levels can be calculated by using modified hydrogen model. For example, a shallow donor resembles hydrogen atom with positive nucleus binding an electron . So for example, if we take a shallow donor in silicon, let me draw some silicon atoms. These are silicon atoms. And let's assume this is a donor atom. This is silicon atom, and this represent a donor atom, just like phosphorus being. So this donor donates an electron, and this electron is bound to this nucleus or this positive charge donor. So let's say this electron is revolving in this orbit. So here we can assume that this electron or this nucleus now acting as hydrogen atom. Here this electron is bounded to the nucleus of impurity atom. Impurity elements which are used as dopants in semiconductors normally creates these shallow levels which are ionized at room temperature and provide free carriers to form P-type or N-type semiconductors. Now if we think about this hydrogen-like atom, the energy required to remove the or remove an electron from a donor atom can be approximated using hydrogen-like model. After all, the donor atom consists of positive charged ion and electron just like proton and electron of the hydrogen atom. However, the difference is that the average distance here, this is the average distance or between nucleus and electron. So that the average distance or between the electron and the donor ion is much larger since the electron occupies one of the outer orbitals. Here the collection of silicon atoms is treated as a continuous medium. So now our aim is to calculate the total energy of this electron and donor ion by using hydrogen atom model. So we can write the potential energy between positive ion and electron is Vr, and we know that what is the potential energy between a positive charge and a negative charge, which is equal to minus 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught e square by r e r, where e r is the dielectric constant of the medium. Here medium is silicon, so we can use this dielectric constant value of silicon. And if Me star is the effective mass of the electron, then the kinetic energy of this electron would be, that is kinetic energy, which is equal to h cross k square by 2 me star. So this is the kinetic energy of this electron, and this is the potential energy of the system. So by using this potential energy and kinetic energy, we can write Hamiltonian of the system, which is equal to H, that is minus H square del square by 2 me star minus 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught epsilon r, which is relative e square by r. So now we have to calculate this Hamiltonian. And we can see this equation is just the equation for a hydrogen atom. And by using Bohr's model, the energy En would be, so En, I am writing directly here the value of energy, which is equal to minus 13.6 by Er square into Me star by Me into 1 by n square. So this is the ionization energy. And since we are using an example of donor level, so we know that the energy level of this donor level is ED, and if we use acceptors, then this energy is EA. So now we have to calculate this energy by using, if this is the EC and this is EV, so we have to calculate this energy by using hydrogen model, and this energy is equal to this. So for n is equal to 1, we can write what is En. En is Ec minus Ed, so which is equal to minus 13.6 by Er square into Me star by Me, where Me is the effective mass of the electron. And from this equation, we can also calculate value of R or RC or RN, which is equal to, we know that Bohr radius is directly proportional to N squared. So here we can write RN, which is equal to ME by ME star ER into A naught N square, where A naught is the Bohr radius. So this is larger than Bohr radius because now the potential is weaker due to this dielectric medium. So if potential is lower, then this average distance should be larger than the equivalent radius in hydrogen atom. So for example, in silicon, ER just near to 10 and ME star near to 0.1 ME. So then E equal to minus 13.6 by 100. Into 10, which is equal to 13.6 by 1000, or in the range of milli electron volt. Similarly, we can get energy of holes by assuming the same hydrogen atom like model. Now here we have to consider this acceptor, and in a similar fashion, if here hole is here, then applying the same mathematics we can get energy required for a hole, which is equal to E minus 13.6 ER square MH star by ME. So this is the energy for hole. We have to just replace the mass of the electron by mass of the effective mass of the hole. And this equation is very important because you can see many numerical problems in competitive exams like GATE, NET, and JEST based on this problem. So here we calculated the energy required for ionization of the donor or acceptor levels. So the energy level created by these impurity levels are known as shallow levels. There are other type of levels which is known as deep levels. These defects are positioned deeper in the band gap than the dopants or shallow levels. And are found to bind the carriers much more strongly into highly complex localized states. So if this is conduction band and this is valence band, and this is minimum of the conduction band, and this is maxima of the valence band. So normally these are the dopants level, or shallow levels, as I discussed earlier. So now deep levels are positioned deeply in the band gap. So these are deep levels. On shallow levels, we can estimate their ionization energy using hydrogen-like model, but we can't calculate energy levels for these deep levels. Because deep levels have higher energy or higher ionization energies, therefore contribute very little to the free charge carriers. These levels are often referred to as traps recombination center, or generation centers. Thus, deep levels act as stepping stones for electrons between the conduction band and valence band. Making a substantial enhancement in the recombination process. depending upon the its location, depending upon its location in the band gap. A deep level may act as an electron or hole trap or a recombination center. At recombination center, the probability of electron and hole captures are nearly equal. An electron trap has a high probability of capturing a conduction electron and setting it free after some time. Similarly, a hole trap has a high probability of capturing a hole that is subsequently released into the valence band, thus an electron capture is followed by a hole capture and this results in the elimination of an electron hole pair. The potential energy of the system or of the pair is lowered in two stages. Part of the energy is released when the electron makes a transition from a state in the conduction band to the deep levels, centers, and the rest energy is released when trapped electron recombines with hole. In general, in both steps, the energy is dissipated in the form of phonons and the recombination is non-radiative. These deep levels are very important. That is, deep levels are very important in semiconductor since they modify the properties of the semiconductors. and therefore those of the devices fabricated thereon. Deep levels are desirable in some applications for example in fast switching devices where they can exploited as recombination centers which quickly remove minority carriers. And hence enhances the switching speed. Deep levels may also be nuisance if present in semiconductors that are used for photovoltaic applications. Since they reduce the cell's efficiency by allowing generated electron hole pairs to recombine. Therefore, study of deep levels are very important in semiconductor device industry so that deep levels which are useful can be deliberately added and those are harmful can be reduced or eliminated. So, in this lecture, we see the shallow levels and deep levels, and we can see some facts about deep levels, why we need deep levels and why we don't need deep levels.